All right, it's great to be here. It's a fantastic event. I'm here to tell you about personnel selection and monitoring in the quest for capable government. What you see here on the right is a map showing you the Human Development Index for the countries of the world. And you see in the darkest blue shades the countries that have very high levels of development. And what you see on the map on the left is that those countries with high levels of Human Development Index tend to be, again, in blue, and those are countries that happen to have well-functioning states. Now, this should not come as a complete surprise because states produce a variety of valuable public goods like pollution regulation and justice and infrastructure. And those are produced within what we could call the factory of the state, and ultimately the factory of the state is operated by public sector employees. And so what that means is that it is important to select the right people to work for the state and to motivate them to perform. Now, there are challenges in doing this. The first one is trying to come up with a way to identify who the right people are. We might think that we want smart people to work for the state, or people with a lot of experience, or people with a particular type of personality, or people with a vocation for public service. Even if we could measure what a good quality person is, or what the right person is, and even if we could find them once we know what they look like, we would still have to convince them to come work for the state, which is a completely different challenge. One natural question is whether we can pay our way out of the problem by simply throwing money at the problem, just pay these people more, and hopefully that will convince them. Now, we may have a subsequent concern that maybe by paying a lot, we may resolve one problem. Maybe we can attract smart people, but we may improve that margin at the cost of ruining some other margins. For example, attracting people who are greedy and who are in it for the money and not because they have the right kind of vocation. So this is overall the problem of selection of personnel for the state. Now, suppose you could identify who these people are and that you could convince them to come and work for the state. Then you face a subsequent problem, which is to motivate these people to perform. And this is particularly hard when schemes of performance pay, which are typically used in the private sector, are infeasible given the complexity of the tasks that some of the state agents have to carry out, or because you simply just don't have the money because the state is poor. And so it is tempting to think that we may use increasingly available technologies that can come, you know, relatively cheap to monitor state agents and in that way induce them to perform. In particular, this is a tempting possibility when state agents are far-flung and they are hard to supervise. So what I'm going to tell you about is two projects based on RCTs that we have done to address each one of these problems, the problem of selection of state personnel and the problem of monitoring and motivation. So let's go into the first problem. So this is a project that we did in partnership with the federal government of Mexico. The federal government of Mexico wanted to develop a network of community development agents that would embed themselves in often remote communities that basically had a lot of needs that were not being satisfied. These were places where the state was effectively absent, and the government wanted to assert their presence there and satisfy the needs of these populations. So what the agents would have to do is embed themselves there, provide their assessment of need, and then make sure that the government would come into these places and solve the problems that needed to be fixed. So now this generated some debates within our Mexican partners. How do we do to hire good people, in particular in places that may be distant or difficult to work in? And how much should they be paid? And in particular, they had debates as to whether paying more was a good or a bad thing because of this problem that you want to pay more to attract smart individuals, but maybe that ruins the vocational profile of the people you attract. So This debate was happily resolved by deciding to randomize the wages that were going to be offered in over 100 locations across the country. So what we did was to develop an approach to measure a number of characteristics of these people. So the way this worked is ads were placed in over 100 locations, which are indicated in the map. And when people called after seeing these ads to a 1-800 number, trained operators will tell them about the job, and they will tell the candidate that they needed to show up at a particular date and time to sit an evaluation exam, which is how we would learn a lot of features of these individuals. And then they would tell them, depending on where they were calling from, what the prospective salary was. So if the person was calling from a location in red in this map, then they would be told that the salary was the equivalent of 375 pesos a month. So what you see there is the, it would be $375 a month. What you see there is the equivalent in Mexican pesos at the time. And if they happen to be calling from one of the blue triangle places, then they would be told that the salary would be about a third higher. So these would allow us to see, for example, what were the properties of the applicant pool that would materialize in each of these places. Now, once they showed up, what did we look at in order to determine who's right for the job? So we looked at their intelligence through well-established IQ tests. This is an example of the Raven's matrix. We used well-established personality tests in psychology, in particular the well-known Big Five inventory. We implemented experimental games to measure altruism and pro-sociality. And we implemented an inventory that measures the degree of public service motivation of the person. What did we find? So the first thing we found is that wages help, higher wages help, improve the quality of your applicant pool. In particular, what we found was that we attracted smarter individuals in places where the wages were higher. What you see in the graph on the on my right, that's your left, is in the x-axis different scores that are possible in the intelligence test. That test had a score that could go from 0 to 12. And you can consider people scoring 9, 10, or more as the high IQ individuals. That is the two sets of bars to the rightmost part of the graph. And what we do there is differentiate the number of people measured in the y-axis in a representative site that showed up. And so what you see is that the blue bars are higher for the two highest IQ categories. And what that is telling you is roughly you get two extra people in each of those two high IQ categories in the typical site when you're offering a wage that is higher. Now, you might say, well, okay, I can believe that a higher wage would attract smarter individuals, but what if you get people with the wrong vocational profile? And that worry is alleviated, we think, by the graph you see to your right. What you see in the x-axis is an index that measures the public service motivation of the candidate. And what you see is two distributions, giving you an idea of the density. And the one with the light, the blue line, tells you the distribution in places where we offer the high wage. And the broken red line shows you the distribution in places where the low wage was offered. And what you see is that those two distributions are not very different. In fact, if anything, you see a little bit more of mass in relatively high levels of public service motivation in the places where the high wage was offered. So the takeaway from this is that the higher wages attracted smarter people, and if anything, they were slightly better motivated to work for the state. Now, looking at these characteristics and ascertaining the profile of the typical applicant is one part of the problem. The other part of the problem is getting to yes. You have to persuade these people to come and work for the state. And what you see is that the higher wages achieve that. Where we offered high wages and then people were selected to receive a job, in places where the high wage was in place, people said yes 55% of the time against only 42% of the time in places where the wage was low. In particular, this was helpful when we were asking people to go work in places that were far away. And the same is true about other relatively undesirable characteristics of job locations. What you see in the rightmost graph is that what you see in the x-axis is the distance in kilometers between the candidate's home and the place where they were being asked to go work. And what you see in the broken blue line that is decreasing is that the more distant the job is, the less likely it is that the person is going to say yes. That line tells you the proportion or the probability that the person is going to say yes. But when you look at places where the high wage was in place, you see an initial similar decrease, but then the probability that people accept the job becomes completely independent of distance, which we believe is driven by the fact that if people are receiving the high wage, eventually when the distance is too much, they decide to relocate. So what this is telling us is that there are significant gains in terms of attracting talent to government or to the state from offering higher wages, and this is particularly helpful in difficult places. Now, once you have these people, then is it possible to motivate them to perform? And so this we're going to answer in a different experiment in a different part of the world. This was done in partnership with the Paraguayan government. This project was also in collaboration with my Berkeley and CEGA colleague Fred Finan, and this time with a number of other co-authors, Nicholas Lee, who is a Berkeley PhD student, and Laura Schechter at the University of Wisconsin. In this case, this emerged from a conversation with high-ranking Paraguayan officials who were trying to make a decisive change in the fight against poverty. And a key element in the fight against poverty is giving assistance to poor farmers. The way they do this is by assisting these farmers through agricultural extension agents. Now, these agricultural extension agents have to cover vast areas, and the supervisors that are right on top of them and in charge of seeing whether they are doing their work have a very difficult time knowing whether these AEAs, or agricultural extension agents, are actually going and doing the rounds and visiting the farmers they're supposed to visit. So the government decided that one way they could try to solve this problem was to issue GPS-enabled phones for these agricultural extension agents. Once they had those phones with them, their supervisor would be able to track them on a map and see whether they were actually going to the places where they were supposed to be going. Now, one problem was they did not have enough phones to give to everybody at once. So there was a question as to who should be treated first with one of these phones. We were then interested in doing two things. One was to evaluate whether issuing these phones to agricultural extension agents by increasing monitoring by the supervisors made these agents go visit farmers more, which is the key metric to determine whether they're actually doing their job. But the other thing was to determine whether there would be more effective ways to deploy this technology. In particular, we were interested to know whether supervisors could be consulted to determine who should be treated first, given that these phones were scarce. And this goes to a very old question in economics. We tend to think that, you know, an advantage of markets relative to central planning is that there is a lot of information dispersed out there. Or that an advantage of delegation and decentralization is that even within an organization, middle managers and workers have valuable information. So is it the case that in this instance, the supervisors would have better information about which of their agents should be treated first? So we did two things. One is we randomized the assignment of the phones to the agricultural extension agents. And the other was we asked the supervisors, if we are going to give phones to a half of the agents that you supervise, which half should we treat first? So this is the second question we wanted to figure out the answer to. So with respect to the first question, what we found is when we went and asked farmers whether they had received the visit from their agricultural extension agent in the previous week, farmers that were dealing with a treated agent, one with a phone, well, those were 7 percentage points more likely to have received the visit. So it seemed like the increased monitoring from the phones really pushed these agents to do more visits. But interestingly, it is the case that supervisors seem to have a lot of valuable information about who should be treated first, who might be responsive to treatment, and who might be recalcitrants who don't respond. In fact, if you break down those two categories of control and treatment for agents, what you see is that the entirety of the treatment effect is driven by those agents that would have been selected by the supervisors had it been in their power to assign the phones in the first place. Those agents that they thought would be recalcitrants that would not be responsive, in fact, we found no effects on those. So this leads to a question that's the following, which we think is interesting. If it is the case that lower levels in an organization have valuable information, does it mean we should contemplate further decentralization in state organizations and in other organizations more generally? At first glance, this might seem to be the case. If we were to randomly allocate the phones, something the minister could have done, right, easy to do, the treatment effect in terms of enhanced visits or more frequent visits would have been 7%. If you were to ask the supervisors, this is the decentralized approach, to do this allocation, then the impact is almost twice as big. So, you know, decentralization seems to be successful. But when you think about it, we have a lot of information here that maybe historically hasn't been so easily accessible to some of these states, but now is becoming increasingly accessible. If you were to take basic information on the demographics of the agricultural extension agents and the distance of the farmers that they're serving, and you apply the machine learning algorithm to this problem, then you could replicate the enhanced performance that you get when you decentralize the decision. But this is something that you could do from a center. Everything you need is the data and a laptop. Moreover, if you are sophisticated, quote unquote, and you run an experiment much like ours and then apply a machine learning algorithm to predict responsiveness to treatment, then you can do significantly better than even the supervisors could do. So what this tells us is that in an era in which data capabilities are becoming more accessible to typically low state capability countries, then maybe we may see more centralized decision making when it comes to the management of human resources. So to wrap up, I would like to take some conclusions about what these two studies tell us about the current situation of workers in the state sector and the future. We are seeing improved data capabilities in many states in the developing world. In fact, measurement is getting a lot better. Data processing capabilities are getting better. And there is an increased marriage, I would say, between state operations and experimental methods. In fact, from CEGA here at Berkeley, we have been leading initiatives that are creating exactly these kinds of partnerships between scientists and governments. This includes often big data, machine learning, artificial intelligence, and this is an increasing trend. It's not going anywhere. If anything, we are at the very beginning of these changes. And we think that this stands to transform state structures and the way in which public sector personnel is engaged and utilized and deployed. So this presents enormous opportunities for increasing the effectiveness of state agents and for increasing the reach of states. But we think it's important to note that there are concomitant challenges to be careful with. In particular, we are going to have a lot of data on a lot of people, and it's important that this data be used to enhance the effectiveness of state agents while being respectful of the freedom of autonomy of those agents and the citizens that they serve. Thank you very much.
We are running fairly short on time, so
I'm happy to talk to people offline. Yeah.